Hello everyone. Today we will be going to discuss acute kidney injury. Because of my step 2 CK preparation, I was not able to make videos, okay? But now I'll try my best to make videos more frequently. So, acute kidney injury. Now, there are three causes of acute kidney injury. Means there are three different locations which can cause acute kidney injury. The cause can be pre-renal, that is before the kidney. It can be intrinsic renal, that is damage to the renal parenchyma, or it can be postrenal. So there any one of this can be the cause of acute kidney injury. Now, the hallmark manifestation of acute kidney injury is azotemia. So what is azotemia? See, azotemia is increase in blood urea nitrogen and creatinine. Okay, blood urea nitrogen and creatinine. If it increases, then it is called azotemia, and that is the main sign of acute kidney injury. Now, what is the normal blood urea nitrogen to creatinine ratio? The normal ratio is 15, okay? So, in a healthy person, the ratio should be 15. Now, to understand the manifestation of the different cause of acute kidney injury, means how they will present. See, if the acute kidney injury is due to pre-renal cause, then the lab values will be different, okay? If it is due to intrarenal cause, then it will be different. So, to understand that, we should ask three questions. So which are the three questions? See, first you should ask, is the tubular epithelium damaged? Means, is the tubular epithelium in the tubules of kidney is damaged or not? If it is damaged, then the concentrating ability of kidney is lost. That is, if the tubular epithelium is damaged, then we will have dilute urine. That's the first point, okay? Now, the second question you should ask is, what will be the aldosterone level? And third question is, what will be the antidiuretic hormone level? If you ask these three questions and think logically, then it will be very easy to understand all the causes of acute kidney injury. So let's begin with the first cause. See, the first is pre-renal azotemia, okay? And what are the causes? Mainly it is due to decrease in blood volume, or it is due to decrease in blood pressure, that is sepsis, hypotension, dehydration, bleeding, whatever it can be. Now, there are two causes which most of us tend to forget. It is cirrhosis and pancreatitis. In pancreatitis, there is loss of fluid due to third spacing, okay? So remember that in cirrhosis and pancreatitis, both of them can manifest as pre-renal azotemia, and they can present as acute kidney injury. Now let's try to understand the values which we get in pre-renal azotemia. See, what will be the burn to creatinine ratio in pre-renal azotemia? It will be greater than 20. What is the normal? It is 15. Why is it greater than 20? Let's try to understand. See, this is glomerulus, this is efferent arteriole, and this is efferent arteriole, and this is the tubule, okay? I haven't drawn the whole nephron, but I think it will be easy to understand from this one, this much. See, both burn, that is blood urea nitrogen or urea you can say, and creatinine are filtered in the kidney, okay? Now, in pre-renal azotemia, we have decreased plasma volume, okay? So we have decreased filtration of everything, okay? Now, both blood urea nitrogen and creatinine are filtered, but as we all know that creatinine cannot be reabsorbed. Creatinine cannot be reabsorbed, okay? But we can reabsorb blood urea nitrogen, okay? We can reabsorb blood urea nitrogen, and there is less volume. The kidney are kind of, they are relaxing. The kidney are relaxing, means kidney has less work to do. So it will be easy for kidney to absorb more blood urea nitrogen. So kidney will not be absorbing creatinine, but it will keep on absorbing blood urea nitrogen. So the blood urea nitrogen will go into the blood, okay, and the ratio will increase. See, the blood urea nitrogen will keep on increasing because it is reabsorbed, but creatinine is not reabsorbed. So the ratio will keep on increasing, and thus we have blood urea nitrogen to creatinine ratio of greater than 20. Always remember that blood urea nitrogen reabsorption is flow dependent. That is, if the flow of fluid will be less in tubules, more urea will be absorbed. And if the flow is greater, then less urea will be absorbed. Remember that. Now, the second one is urine sodium. Okay, see, as we all know that in pre-renal azotemia, the blood volume and pressure both are less. So we will have increase in renin angiotensin aldosterone system activation. Now as this system is activated, we will have more aldosterone, okay? And as we have more aldosterone, we will absorb more sodium, right? More sodium and more water. Both sodium and water both are absorbed under the effect of aldosterone. Now as the sodium is more absorbed, you will excrete less sodium, okay? So as we excrete less sodium, the urine sodium will be less than 20. Now what will be fractional excretion of sodium? It will be also less. See, both of these are similar thing, but urine sodium, it is a gross value, while fractional excretion, it is a ratio. Both of them are similar thing, but this is a ratio, okay, while this is a gross value. That's the only difference. So as you are excreting less sodium because of effect of aldosterone, you will have less urine sodium and less fractional excretion of sodium. Okay, now are the tubular epithelium damaged here? The answer is no. The tubular epithelium is not damaged, so kidney will still produce concentrated urine, and as kidney will produce more concentrated urine, the ratio will be greater than 500. Okay, it will be concentrated. Now see, another way to understand is that aldosterone is absorbing sodium and water, right? And under the effect of antidiuretic hormone, we will absorb water. So overall, more water is reabsorbed, see, under effect of aldosterone as well as antidiuretic hormone. So more water is reabsorbed, so again we will produce concentrated urine. So these are the two ways of understanding that. Now another major point that most of people forget is that if there is pre-renal azotemia, okay, and the blood volume and blood pressure is really low, okay, then it may cause ischemia in the tubules. It may cause ischemia in the kidney, and that can cause acute tubular necrosis, and now this will manifest as intrinsic renal azotemia. It is very important to remember this thing, that whenever there is decrease in blood volume and blood pressure, then there will be pre-renal azotemia. But if the decrease is very severe and it leads to ischemia of the tubules and the epithelium is damaged, then the same condition will now manifest as intrinsic renal azotemia. Okay, so remember that. Now we will be discussing intrinsic renal azotemia. Now the main thing in intrinsic renal azotemia is that the tubular epithelium, they are damaged. Simple, okay? The tubular epithelium is damaged. Now as the tubular epithelium is damaged, see, we know that both blood urea nitrogen and creatinine are filtered, right? But as the tubular epithelium is damaged, we will not be able to reabsorb blood urea nitrogen. Also, when there is problem in kidney and kidney is unable to excrete blood urea nitrogen, then the blood urea nitrogen in blood is increasing. Also creatinine is increasing because the kidney are unable to excrete both of them properly. Okay, so both are increasing. Now when the blood urea nitrogen increases in the blood, what happens is that body tries to excrete it by some other means. So remember that when there is kidney injury, blood urea nitrogen is also lost in GI tract and it is also lost through skin. So overall, this will result in decrease in blood urea nitrogen to creatinine ratio. See, why is it decreased? Because blood urea nitrogen is lost in GI tract, it is lost through skin, okay, and also the tubules are unable to absorb the blood urea nitrogen. This will result in decrease in blood urea nitrogen to creatinine ratio, that is, it will be less than 15. Now as the tubules are damaged, it cannot absorb sodium. Sodium cannot be absorbed. Okay, so the urine sodium value will be high. See, it is more than 40. The fractional excretion will also be high because we are excreting more sodium. We are excreting the sodium, okay? Now what will be the urine osmolality? As we discussed earlier, that if the tubular epithelium is damaged, the concentrating ability is lost. Okay, the concentrating ability of the kidneys are lost. So the kidney will start producing dilute urine. Okay, that is the urine osmolality is less than 350. So remember this. Now the last one is postrenal azotemia. Now this one is slightly more trickier than prerenal and renal azotemia, but hopefully it will be easy to understand if we understand it logically. Okay, see what is the problem in postrenal azotemia. There is some kind of obstruction or block here. Okay, so that will lead to backup of the fluid. The fluid will means the urine will not be excreted, it will keep on accumulating in the tubules. Now what happens is that initially when there is the fluid is accumulating here, there will be pressure here, pressure building up here. This pressure will cause more blood urea nitrogen to be reabsorbed. Okay, so more blood urea nitrogen is reabsorbed back into the blood. Now as more blood urea nitrogen is reabsorbed, the blood urea nitrogen to creatinine ratio will be more than 15. Okay, that is the first manifestation, initial manifestation. Now if the obstruction remains for longer time, then the increase in pressure will be too much and it will eventually start damaging the epithelium. See, it will start damaging the epithelium, and once the epithelium is damaged, you cannot reabsorb blood urea nitrogen. Now you cannot reabsorb the blood urea nitrogen. The ratio of blood urea nitrogen to creatinine will be less than 15, because as the epithelium is damaged, the blood urea nitrogen will not go back into the blood. So the blood urea nitrogen to creatinine ratio will be now less than 15. Now as the epithelium is damaged, plus here there is fluid overload, okay, we are not able to excrete fluid, so the aldosterone level will be low, okay, the ADH level will be low, and also we have tubular epithelium damage, right? We have tubular epithelium which is knocked out, damaged. So because of all these three, okay, mainly due to aldosterone and tubular epithelium damage, we will not be able to reabsorb sodium, and thus the sodium in urine will be more. Okay, we will not be able to absorb sodium, so the fractional excretion of sodium will also be high. Now see, initially as we said that tubular epithelium is not damaged much, so the fractional excretion is less than 1, but when all the epithelium is damaged, the fractional excretion increases to more than 2, means we are not able to absorb any sodium. Okay, we are not able to absorb. Now as we said that tubular epithelium, whenever it is damaged, the concentrating ability is lost, and thus we will have dilute urine. Dilute urine means the osmolality is less than 350. Now see, here we have increase in sodium in urine, but still we are having dilute urine. Why? Because sodium is lost, but even more water is lost. That's the main key point. Okay, because ADH is unable to, is its level is low, aldosterone level is low, so none of them are absorbing water, and only aldosterone is not absorbing the sodium. So more water is lost here, and also sodium is lost, but the loss of water is much more than the loss of sodium. That's why we have dilute urine. So hopefully by remembering all this point, it will be really easy for you to understand the acute kidney injury or acute renal failure.